you know.
Tell him what you want.
Yeah.
If you need the Holy Ghost,
tell him
what you want.
All you got to do.
Call him up.
Yeah,
and tell him what you want. What you want.
If you need a little more. Come on, church.
Call him up and tell him what you want.
Tell God what you need.
Call him up.
Come on.
And tell him what you want.
Call him in the morning.
Call him up.
Yeah.
And tell him what you want.
Call him in the new day.
Call him up.
Come on, God.
And tell him what you want.
He'll be right there.
Call him up and tell him what you want.
It make no difference.
Call him up and tell him what you want.
If you call him up, dog.
Call him up. And tell him what you want.
You got to call him.
Call Jesus.
Call him up.
Call Jesus.
Anybody want to call him?
Call Jesus.
You got to call him.
Call Jesus.
Whatever your need is.
Call Jesus.
You got to call him.
Call Jesus.
You got to call him.
Call Jesus.
You got to call him.
Call Jesus.
Well, call him.
Call him up.
Come on now.
And tell him what you want.
Come on and call him.
Call him up.
Call him.
And tell him what you want.
What else your problem is?
Call him up.
You got to call
him. What you want.
If you need,
call him up.
You got to
tell him what you want.
If you need a friend,
call Jesus.
You got to call him.
Call Jesus.
You got to call him.
Call Jesus.
You got to call him.
Call Jesus.
Thank Jesus.
Call Jesus.
I need you.
Call Jesus.
Jesus.
Call Jesus.
I need you.
Call Jesus.
Call him up.
Call him up.
Yeah.
And tell him what you want.
Whatever the problem is.
Call him up.
You got
and
to
tell him what you want.
If you stay,
call him up.
And you can't get
and tell him what you want.
You got to call him.
Call him up.
I'll be my
and tell him what you want.
Come on, y'all, call him.
Call him up.
Come on, call him.
And tell him what you want.
You got to call him tonight.
Call him up.
Whatever the problem
tell
is.
What you want.
If you need healing,
call him up.
You got to
tell him what you want.
If you down,
call him up.
You need to pick
him
up.
What you want.
If you burden,
call Jesus.
Burden down.
Call Jesus.
Call him.
Call Jesus.
Call him up.
Call Jesus.
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 Call him.
Come on out.
Anybody out there?
Call him up.
Anybody out there? You know what you gotta do tonight.
Call him up.
You know what you gotta do tonight.
What you want.
You got to call him up.
Call him up.
You got to
call him up.
If you burn him, you need to lift you.
Call him up.
You got to
tell him what you want. Call him up and tell him what you want. Call him up and tell him what you want. Call him up and tell him what you want.
Come on and help him.
Call him up.
Come on and
tell him what you want.
I need help.
Like calling Jesus, y'all. Ain't nothing like calling that name. Hey, come on now. Do you feel him? Do you feel him now? Hey, I said call him up. Anybody want to call him?
Hallelujah.
Anybody want to call him?
Call him
up. You can call him in the midnight hour. You can call him in the morning, yes. Anybody want to call him? Anybody want to call him? He never, never late. He's always listening, yeah.
Yes, he is.
Anybody want to call him?
Come on now.
He's right there. All you got to do is call him.
And tell him what you want.
Yeah,
call him up and tell him what you want.
Yeah,
call him up and tell him what you want.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Call him up and tell him what you want.
Now we're going to turn the service over to the hands of our pastor. Give her a great big amen as she comes.
Yes, how we love that name, Jesus. The sweetest name I know. He's so good, it's so wonderful. We're so happy for all of you that are here tonight. Special welcome to any visitors we may have. We're grateful for all that God has done and continues to do. He loves us more than anybody in the whole world. We are so blessed. We are a blessed people to have what we have today. And I am so thankful for him and for what he has done and for how he's proved himself time and time again. That's one person you don't have to doubt.
Right.
You don't have to wonder if he's going to do it. He's already been proven. God is so good and so wonderful. Yes, we want to get right into the word right away so I can go home and let you go home. Yes. Glory be to God. I'm so glad, sir, that you're here too. I'm glad about that. And you know what? When you choose the right road, you can do things right. You can either go back where you come from or keep going ahead to things better. There's a lot of good things about God. A lot of good things. Have your Bibles turn with me to Judges, the 16th chapter. Father, we're so grateful for your blessings, for all that you've done for us. It's a privilege to be in your house tonight to lift up your name. We pray, God, that you might be glorified in all that we say or do. I pray now for the anointing of God, that you break every yoke and every chain, that you might speak to your people as only you can, and we'll give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I'm in the 16th chapter of Judges. The 21st verse says, but the Philistines took him, talking about Samson, and put out his eyes and brought him down to Gaza, and bound him with fetters of brass, and he did grind in the prison house. I want to preach to you a little while tonight. There was a time that Samson did very well, very well. He had power in his life. He was excited and all the things that God had done for this man. He had a great testimony. He was a leader for 20 years. You think if you've been there that long, surely you're going to stay. Doesn't mean that. But as I looked at this, one thing I noticed that stood out to me was that after they got him, they blinded him. They put his eyes out so he couldn't see. And so now you can't even find your way back to where you were lost at. That I could somehow start this all over again. But when I looked at that, I said to myself, how many times do the devil take people and put their eyes out, and the thing you used to could see and understand, you can't see and understand it no more. Somebody could be talking to you, explaining things to you, and you can't see it. You can't see it. Now, I want you to understand that God speaks to his people in many ways. In many ways. But when I look at this, I'm thinking, okay, we need to see. It's not that I hear you, I just hear you, but I need to see what you're talking about. I need to have understanding of what's going on. So when I thought about Samson, I thought, God, I would not want to be in that place. Now, if you go back even to where Eli was the high priest, but he did things not quite right. Now, understand, when he began to get older, his eyesight began to go. But I'd like to bring some reference to that in a spiritual term. That he couldn't see good because had he seen good, he wouldn't have kept going along with his sons. And so when you can't see, the devil's for sure going to put you out. I got to be able to know where I'm going. If every person in this building was blind tonight, trying to get out here, get out of this church would be kind of difficult. Because you find yourself trying to feel your way through there and hold on to the pew and is this where I turn at? I mean, it would be an uncomfortable feeling. I've often looked at blind people, the natural thing, wow, how must that feel? They have eyes, but they can't see. They have ears, but they can't hear. Sometimes people are messed up on both sides, but nothing is worse than when we can't hear, when we can't see and know what God is telling us to do. Because once we get off track, it's very hard to get back on. And when the devil puts your eyes out, the only person that can give it back to you is God. And so if he's not giving it to you, you're probably never going to get it back. So think for a minute that when you hear the voice of God speaking to you, you want to listen to it, you want to hear it, and you want to see it. I can understand. Seeing brings understanding. So if I don't have understanding, how can I know what to do? Now, if the devil says, well, if I can blind them to where they can't see what you're saying, he knows he can take you any place he wants to. Because I don't understand. And you're sitting there talking to people. They look at you like this. Well, what are you talking about? The Bible says the God of this world has blinded their eyes that they cannot see. He has done something to the hearing of man that causes him not to be able to hear. One thing that will take you to hell quicker than anything is the fact that the devil got you blind to the truth. Because I don't believe this about me. I believe I'm okay, and I think this, and I think that. But you know what? If you don't hear the word, if you don't see yourself for who you are, you know how long you're going to be messed up. When you hear the truth, you understand what God is saying. It's whether you move on it or not. And so we got too many people that hear it, but they don't hear. See, they don't see. Because somehow I got blinders on. I don't know how they got on there, but I got them. And so, no, it's not clear. Every person that backslides, every person, lose their sight and lose their hearing. Every person. Because I'm telling you, they say, well, I didn't know I was doing wrong. I'm thinking, where are you at? You better understand, when I just get off on the wrong track, I need to get back on. But the thing about it, once the devil does a job to you, there's not much you can fix. That's right. And I have found myself talking to people, explaining where the devil's seat is, and for a moment they'll say, yeah, but I can tell they didn't get it. Okay. It's almost like somewhere in there is this darkness that I just can't see or hear what you're talking. I hear you, it sounds familiar, but I still can't grasp it. And if you cannot grasp the truth, rest assured the devil is going to defeat you. Because he loves a lot of people. He likes telling you how good you are, how great you are, and you're okay the way you are. Don't buy that. Because for sure we all want to go to heaven when it's all over here. Well, then I better know if I'm wrong, if I'm on the wrong track, if I'm doing something wrong. I better know that. Nothing is worse to me than people saying that they are going to heaven and to me to get there and not. And he said, I don't know you. Now, that's not something you can repent of and get right and do right now. When he said, I don't know you, depart from me. That can't be changed. It is what it is. So since I know that, should I not be very sure of where I am? That I heard the word being spoken to me. I heard what was being said. You got to hear that. You got to see it. Samson was in a bad shape. He was, I mean, this man was falling and stumbling all along the way. From one woman to another, he had issues. And so I'm looking at that and thinking, at what point, right through the, during that time was the devil messing with him, with women. He began to lose his understanding. So, sure, I hear it, but I don't. When his mom and dad said, why would you want to go down and get women and get a wife with the uncircumcised? He didn't even hear them. He said, I said, get her for me. That if you're not doing what you just heard, you didn't get it. Unless you are applying it to your life, you didn't get it. When I know a person heard me, it's when I see change. But if they don't change, they never heard you. They may have amened you. They may have said something about it, whatever, but they didn't hear you. Now, spiritual deafness is the worst thing you can have. I got to understand what you're talking about. And sometimes, have you ever been talking to a person in the room and they just say, oh, okay, they didn't hear you? And later you come back and say, you remember what I told you? Say, no, what did you say? They weren't paying you any attention. The devil loves distractions in people's lives. If I can distract you, keep you from seeing, keep you from hearing, he's got a deadline for every soul. I told you that before. I said, the devil, he sets the stage and said, this is my time to take them out. Every person will get taken out unless they can hear and perceive what God is saying to you and understand the danger in it. It is dangerous for you not to hear. It is dangerous for you not to see. Because you keep on going down the same road. I know you never heard me. No matter what I said, no matter what way I put it to you, you still didn't hear it because you kept doing your own thing. That means spiritually speaking, I'm not seeing and I'm not hearing. You got to hear. Because when you really hear something and you understand it, you immediately begin to change. But people kind of turn the deaf ear. I don't really believe this that way. I'm not that bad, and I'm this person, and I'm that person, whatever. The thing that man thinks about himself is the most ridiculous thing on the world, in the planet. You know why? Because he always thinks the best of himself. He always likes to say, well, I'm not like this one, and I'm not like that one. Come on here. You got to understand, it has nothing to do with whether you're like that person or this person. It's about who you are. And we got to look at the whole picture and say, I got to do something about this. When you really hear me, you get up and do it now. You don't wait till the moment. When God comes across this pulpit and speak to you, I mean directly to you. I know you heard it because by the time I saw you again, there was a change. It's like, no, I got to do this. And when you take it and you do what he says for you to do, it's amazing the freedom and the power that you possess. What made Samson lose his power? He lost his eyes. He lost his eyes. He couldn't see no more. Because before, when the Philistines would come upon him, he said, I'll just go out and shake myself as I did before, and God will be with me. Did you not know you were losing ground? Did you not know you've been lying for a while? And now you just say, I'm going to go out and shake myself as I always do, and God's going to do this for me. No. Somewhere you're going to shake, and it ain't going to be there. One of these days you're going to say, I'll just repeat what I always did. I'll go on a fast. You know some fast God don't even accept? He says a fast I have chosen, not what you picked up. I don't like this feeling that every time people do wrong, they say, I'm going to go on a fast. A fast is not a cure-all. Obedience is a cure-all. If I obey and do what I'm told to do, that's what's going to make the difference. But I got to obey. I got to make up in my mind, what did you tell me to do? I'm doing it right now. If I call you back and you said, no, I haven't done it yet, but I'm going to. No. I think the devil for sure have put in the minds of people something about the hereafter is dull. Hell is dull. You can't really view it. You really can't see that something is wrong. You think, I said, Lord, do the people even believe there's a hell? Because the way they live their life, and they're up and down like a yo-yo, and they never got the victory, and they are not overcomers, they're not victors. God, do they understand? See, every day I look at get that in my life and think, but I got to know it's right in here. I got to know I don't have anything that shouldn't be here every day of my life. Because I'm telling you, you can leave this world just with something in here that'll cost you heaven. I told you about the man that had the vision of heaven, and he went there, and it was so beautiful, and everything was so right, and he loved it, and finally they took him on a tour in heaven, and he saw the beauty and the glory of heaven, and then they took him to hell, and he went, and he looked, and he thought, wow, what a horrible place. It was so far from heaven. It was just horrible screams and pain and suffering and darkness. And he said, I wouldn't want to be here. So he turned around to get ready to leave. He said to the angel, I'm ready to go back to heaven. He says, you can't go to heaven. This is where you'll spend eternity. Can you imagine that? This is where you will spend eternity. You know why? He said, you never forgave your wife for the time that she was unfaithful to you. Can you imagine standing facing God with one thing? This is where you're going to be. I am convinced that the devil has blinded people's eyes, and their understanding has become so dull that when you talk about hell, it's no big thing. You say you better get right. You better pull it together. You better change that situation, because if you don't, you're going to die and go to hell. It's like, yeah. I'm thinking, did you hear me? You will go to hell. They say, yeah, I heard you. No, they didn't. Because I'm telling you without a doubt, that would scare me to death. If somebody said to me, Rose, you're going to die and go to hell, I probably wouldn't sleep again and eat again until God says something to me. But it doesn't faze these people. They hear the message. They see people dying every day. They see people lost, going to hell. And they continue as if that's not going to happen to me. Of course it will. Think about it. Think about what I've been told. Where am I at? I'm still doing the same thing over and over and over again. This is not nothing to play with. Our time in this world is limited. We're not going to be here very long. At the best, if you live to be 70 or 80 years old, that time goes so fast. It's just like, well, where did the time go? You wake up and you think, my God, how old am I? Where did the time go? I tell Juana sometimes, I say, you know what? It seems like we're not out of the pulpit no time before it's back again. It's like you get up on Monday. When Monday leaves, it's Monday, Sunday. Just forget about Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Monday, Sunday. It comes so fast, and especially fast for me. I'm thinking, wow, I'm back again. It's so quick. And the way people live their life, they act like that they got all the time in the world to do what I want to do. And if I haven't made it right, God will help me. You can't die with the thing God's going to help me when he helped you already and you still didn't do it. You got to get up. You got to say, you know what? I'm tired of me. I got tired of Rose. You got to get tired of yourself. Then when people start talking to you, giving you the truth, you'll say, you know what? I'm going to do that. I'm going to change. I'm not going to stay the same. How is it some people come in this church and hear the word, and I mean they grasp hold to it, and this is it for me, this is what I want, and you got folks that's been here forever that's still dragging around, still not praying, still not giving themselves to God. I'm thinking you could wake up any day with a disease, deadly disease. You could have a heart attack at 20 years old. Why do you think? Because, well, I'm young. That means nothing. Young people truly die. People leave this world every day. We hear of deaths. We know people are dying. We have family members who die. What is it about it that it doesn't register? You're not hearing. You got to hear the word. He said, I liken you unto a wise man. Not because you just heard it, but because you did it. So he that heareth the word of God and doeth it, that's what makes you know your hearing is working. Your understanding is enlightened. This is a dangerous path you're on. Listen to me. You spend your life trying your best to hold people back. Please listen, listen. I don't want to hear the words that some member died and wasn't ready to meet God and they sat on the pew just dead. Then what the devil does, when he puts your eyes out, he binds you so that you can't get loose. He ain't gonna even let you feel your way back. He binds you. And you say, I don't know why I can't. I just seem not to, I can't get in. I really don't. I want to praise God, but I don't. You're bound. As Leslie sing the song, you better get them shackles off your feet. Because that's what's got you messed up. You're in a bind. Can't get loose. He said, I'm going to bind you up so you can't get out. Now, when Samson asked the Lord, when he spoke to the lad and said, would you take me to the pillars of this building that holds this building up? Because they're mocking him. They're making fun of him. Can you imagine? The enemy that you have defeated now is laughing at you. That's what he do to a lot of church people. He said, I got you, though. You can shout all you want to. You can talk in some kind of tongue and call it God. But I got you. You know, people, you better know, and you better know well. Am I really in with God? If I die today, would I truly be ready? Or would I have heard but I didn't hear? I never made preparation. Do you know for your whole life you need to be making preparation to die? Because you know it's coming. We don't know when or where, but we know it's coming. And people live their lives as if, I'm not going to worry about it. You better, if you never worried about anything, you better be very concerned whether or not you in the place you should be. That's important. So I look around church and I think, wow. I see some people being blessed and growing and thriving spiritually. And you look a little bit further, just two or three people over, some dead people sitting on the thing. You got to be able to praise and worship. You got to have something going on that everybody knows. You know that this is real and it's happening in my soul. Yes. But when he gets ready to bind you up, you keep sitting there and you reject the truth and you don't take it, he's going to bind you. Listen, he bound Samson with fetters. The fetters means this: to restrain you from motion, action, or progress. Something that confines, something that shackles you, something that restrains you from being able to get loose. A chain or a shackle that they put around your feet, around your waist, and around your hands, you cannot function. Spiritually, if he binds you, you can't get loose. I remember a girl back in Oklahoma. She was the organist or the piano player, I think. And her name was Shirley. Shirley, she backslid. And I remember calling her on the phone and said, Shirley, why don't you come back to church? She said, I can't come back. I said, what do you mean you can't come back? She said, I can't get back. I would like to come back, but I can't get back. When he binds you, he restrains you. So if I did want to go back to church, if I did want to pray, I can't do it. Since I know he has the power to bind me and put my eyes out, am I not going to secure my position? Am I not going to pray and seek the face of God? Or do I just walk around and say, well, I'm not going to worry about it? You better worry about it. You better be concerned. We're talking about heaven or hell here. One of those places you're going to. Either you're going to heaven if you do right, or you're going to hell if you do it wrong. And people act like, well, you know, everybody's in heaven. No, everybody's not going to heaven. Everybody that calls me Lord is not going to come here. Look at your life. What are you? I just go to church because it's church time. I go because it's prayer time. But I don't really have a relationship. No person gets into heaven without a relationship with God. Because if you cease to have a relationship, that means some things is in your life that prevents you from having one. Don't just keep listening to the word and say, you know, I got to change this. I've got to do something. You know, I heard the words Sunday, and I really know I got to do something. And come back next Sunday. I know I got to do something. What are you waiting on? In that week, in that time, you could have died. That may have been the only message you ever hear again. And it's trying to prepare you. It's trying to get you into a place where you need to go. You don't have time to say maybe. And come back next week and say, I know, girl. I said I was going to get it together. I'm going to. This is not funny. This is not funny. This is real. You got to obey. You got to follow what the word says. You got to hear. One thing, the first thing God said to Israel, hear, O Israel. Hear what I'm saying to you. Listen to me. But you got these rebellious people that keep rebelling, and they don't want you to push them or do anything. Just let me be. It's not going to work for you. What the devil does, he hampers you, causing you to be in a tight restraint. So I can't get loose. And it goes on a little bit further talking about the fetters. It suggests a restraining so severe that freedom to move or progress is almost lost. It's almost lost because you're so far messed up. And for you, for me to tell you the truth about yourself and you look at it like, yeah, that's not funny. God is saying, you land in hell real quick, you'll find out nothing is funny. I said to a person I was talking to the other day, I said, 1 second in hell, 1 second. You everything you say you couldn't do and wasn't possible to do, you found out you could do it with ease. But the truth is, if you go to hell, you're not coming back. You can't fix it. It is what it is. Think about it. Lord, where am I at? Can I really hear? Can I really see? Or am I just talking and going through the motion? But what's going on in here? What's going on? I'm not up and down. Sometimes even with the ground. You can't afford that. If you go down, that could be the time the devil takes you out and you never get back up. Because you have a pattern of doing this, of going up, going down, going up and coming down, going up and coming down. And devil said, I'm going to get him on the next down. You're not praying. You're not solid. No. You better think for a minute. You better take this message very serious. So the fetters is so severe that he binds you with until to move a progress is almost impossible. And then I understood what Shirley meant when she said, I can't come back. I want to, but I can't. Keep sitting here, hearing the word, but not applying it. You're hearing, but you're not hearing. You see, but you don't see. I got to change that. I got to put this into my heart and my mind. I look at Larry sometimes, and I'm thinking this. I've been knowing this man since he was 20 years old. He is now what? 59. A young boy when he came to the church in Germany. And I'm looking at him now thinking, how did you get here? The table is set. It's plenty of food. How did this happen to you? This is the man I've been knowing all these years. When singing is going on, oh, he loves to sing. But singing won't get you to heaven. It's the life that you live in here. What's in your heart? What's in your mind, whether you're going to get there or not? Where are you at? I better take a look at myself and quit sitting around here just thinking, you know, everything. I'm going to do better. That right there is going to stop a lot of people. I'm going to change this. I'm going to change that. But in actuality, they don't do it. You can't afford to put it off. When a person is rebellious, they truly cannot see. I don't want to hear it. This is what I'm going to do. My mind is made up to do it like this, and I don't want to hear nothing you got to say. And tune it out. What a tragedy. I was praying for my oldest son a lot this week, and I thought, God, what is getting ready to happen with this boy? His sin is beyond description. I said, God, teach him a lesson. teach him a lesson. And if somehow you have mercy, that he don't die and go to a devil's hell. But teach him. How many times were you told again and again and again, don't do this, don't do this, don't do it, and did it anyway? What a tragedy. And I look at people in this church, and some of them the Lord bring before me over and over again. I'm thinking, get it together. Do you hear? No. Do you see? No. I don't hear and I don't see. That's why there's no change. And I'm coming back to people with the same thing. Why haven't you changed that? Why? Remember what I told you? You know what the word says? Remember what the message was? Why haven't you changed? It could be months. They still haven't changed. Just sitting on the pew, same way, same place. Ain't got no real shout. Ain't got no real praise. I look at the musicians, I'm thinking, yeah, and Joe will get loose. I might get so tickled because it's almost like he didn't mean to. And he he pulled a thing. I sat down and boy, he began with, I said, what, he can't help himself. I mean, yeah, play the musical instrument, but get your rear end up. Sometimes you need to shout. And if you can't carry the thing with you, lay it down. I'm not going to be bound to anything. Where I can't worship and praise God. And I come to church so I can hear what thus saith the Lord. So I can see what he wants to say to me. Understand it. Because this is another week we're coming upon. What has the devil got planned now? He always plans your week. He plans your week. So what am I going to do? I better get it together. I better quit coming back next Sunday in the same place. When you hear the message today, you need to say to the Lord, heal my ears. Heal my eyes so I can see. Because I don't want Sister Rose telling me all these things and none of it matters. And I really don't believe I'm going. I don't believe I'm going to hell. What you believe ain't got nothing to do with it. A lot of people didn't believe they was going to die today, but they did. So what you going to do? Am I just going to put myself in a position that he can take the advantage of me? That's what rebellious does. He puts you at a disadvantage so you can't fight, so you can't win. So when you continue to turn a deaf ear and close your eyes to the truth, you are at a disadvantage. You really can't win. You may be trying, you may be pushing, but you can't win. When you're at a disadvantage, you can't win. You know, if you get two fighters in the ring and they're fighting each other, if one of them does something to the other one that causes him to be somewhat handicapped, he's at a disadvantage to win. Well, that's what the devil do to the church people all the time. He gives them a handicap and they can't get up good because they're bound. They're talking about freedom, but they're bound. They can't get loose. And you just keep saying, are you hearing me? I'm listening to Tasha. I mean, this is, 4 years have changed me. Something should have changed you by now. You're still the same? No. Something should have changed you. You should not be the same person. And still we are? That's amazing to me. That's a person that somehow the devil's made you feel like, don't worry about it. It's okay. I mean, God knows. I mean, you've been praying. You ain't really been praying. Because if you really pray, you change. If you really pray, you know you heard what the word says. I need to go and pray. I need to go and seek God. After I hear a message, I want to go seek God. You know what? If I deal with any issue with any person that's bad, and I have done that here recently, and I go home and I said, Lord, look, work a work in me. I don't ever want to be there. I had to deal with it. It's so ugly. It's so horrible. God, don't let that be in me. Make me everything that I should be. I want to be that. I don't want to be like just what I talked to, just what I dealt with. I don't want that in my life because I'm looking at you thinking you can't get out. You know what? The spirit of pride always tells you that you're okay. The spirit of pride is a blinder. It is a blinder. You can't see yourself that way. You better believe when God's leader tell you it's messed up, you better believe it's messed up. Yes. Don't put it off. Tomorrow's not promised to any of us. I could very well be standing here preaching the last message that I ever preach. Of course, I'm not going to be that blessed, but in all of that, you got to look at it and say, wait a minute. You should be waiting for the time that your leader said, boy, you've changed. You should be waiting for that. Because sometimes you look in the mirror and you think, I don't know. But ask me. I promise you I will not lie to you. I promise you I will speak the truth to you. Look at yourself. Say, I look at the devil's trying to sideswipe you and put you in a position where you can't fight back. You know, when somebody's talking to us and we don't want to hear what they got to say, we don't have no buttons on our ear, we just tune them out. And they're just talking, you ain't paying them no attention. I do that to my kids sometimes. They talk to me, I say, and they just keep on. She's trying to act like she don't hear us. I'm not thinking about you. Look at it, she's not paying us no attention. You know I don't care what you're saying at this point. It amounts to nothing. Okay? And you know what? That's just the way you do when the word comes for them. The Bible said they turned away. They turned away their ears from hearing the truth, and they turned their back on it. My grandma used to tell me, don't you dare. Because I'm mad anyway because I got to wash dishes and it's not my turn. And she said, don't you dare drag your feet, gal. Because when I start go out there, you can hear me walking. Stuff. Pick your feet up, she said. Pick them up. I just want to know, grandma, why do y'all always forget who did it last? Why is it when I say it's Hannah's turn? Get in there and get it done. Why do you forget all the time? I hate washing dishes. You got to warm up the water. You didn't go to the fountain and to the faucet and turn it on and hot water came out. There was no hot water. You got to get it on the stove and get it hot and then put you some in the other sink so you can rinse the dishes after. I don't want to do all this stuff. And it always happened that way. Rose, get in the kitchen and clean it up. I said, it's Hannah's turn. Get in the kitchen and clean it up. How angry I would be. If I could, I'd have broke every dish, but she'd have beat the crap out of me. No. I'd have never forgot what I did. I had to take it. Sometimes I was standing in the kitchen crying in the dishwater while I'm washing the things, and sometimes I get mad with my sister. I said, why don't you tell her it's your turn? Well, I wasn't in there, Rose. Come in there. If you hear something's going on, come on and do something about it. God is going to come down whatever it takes for some people. You better thank God that he's a God that says, I'm going to take you to heaven in spite of yourself. I'm going to beat all the black off you. Until you say yes to me. Until you give up. That's what happens to a lot of people. That's the mercy of God. I beat you and beat you and beat you until you get it. And then all of a sudden, things really bad start happening. You say, God, I hear you, God. That's what I wanted. That's what I wanted. It ain't complicated. Don't let the devil make you think you don't have to worry about it. Yes, you do. When the devil has pulled you out and told you lies and made you go out the door. Then he said, put his eyes out so he can't find the door anymore. He can't come back. And then as soon as you get him a little bit further, put the chains on him. Bind them. And you said, do you know when the devil binds you, nobody can set you free but God? You don't have the power to do it. The only person that can free you is him. And so you turn your back on the one who could free you. You're not listening to him. He said to the prophet, this is a rebellious people. They don't listen. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he hath also rejected thee from being king. Talking about Saul. Look, so rebellious. Some people are so stubborn. I'm not giving in to that. Yeah, I heard you, but I'm not doing it. They don't even talk back or nothing. I'm not doing it. You're going to hell. Rebellion is worse than the sin of witchcraft. I don't want to be a rebellious person, a stubborn person, set in my way to do things my own way. I don't want to be there. Why can't I just say, yes, Lord? Listen to what he says through Nehemiah. He said, but they and our fathers dealt proudly and hardened their necks and hearkened not to thy commandments. And they refused to obey, neither were mindful of thy wonders that thou didst among them, but hardened their necks, and in their rebellion appointed a captain to return to their bondage. But thou art a God ready to pardon, gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and forsookest them not. He said, you hired you a captain to go back to Egypt? You prayed 400 years to get out? That's man for you. I pray and ask God to fix it. When he fixes it, you're still a fool. Get a grip. You're going to get a captain? Let's make us a captain and go back to Egypt. There was nothing in Egypt for any of us. We all been in Egypt. We were born in Egypt. We know what's there. And we still look for a way. Well, we don't want to do what we're being told to do. I'll just go back to Egypt. That's what that garden boy said that night that I pulled off the platform because he was doing some crap. I can't remember what it was. And he said, well, I think the devil would like to have me back. I thought, if you ain't a fool, you not only look stupid, you are stupid. If you look at people sometimes, they say, do I look stupid? Why do you look stupid? Because you. That's why you look that way. It's real dumb look. Do I look dumb? Why? Because you have a dumb look. The countenance portrays everything. So let me say, I'm not going to follow what other people do. We're a nation of people that tend not to learn from other people's mistakes. We just go ahead and do it anyway, but we don't learn. We don't learn from them. It's like, yeah, you know, the devil tell you, but you're not going to come out like they came out. They didn't do it right. They didn't do this. The boy at home that we went to school with in high school, name was Arthur Allen. Everybody called him Bo. Bo was the hardest boy I ever seen. He did girls so bad. Nobody wanted to sit in front of him in school because he was so dirty. He was so filthy. He was just a mean boy. He took advantage of girls. He never bothered me. I don't know why, because I wouldn't like the rest of them. Praise God for the Holy Ghost. Yeah. But I looked at them and I thought, and one day he just told himself, I can do what I want to do. Nothing's going to happen to me. I'm Bo. Goes down to the grocery store when it's closed and break into the grocery store. And the police that was there saw him, and he came out the store running. They put a bullet in his head. Young, had to be, maybe 15. And I remember when they all come to the funeral, all the cat daddies that think they were so cool, they was all there dressed alike and almost like a gang. And I'm thinking, boy, you thought it couldn't happen to you. He was such a rebellious, stubborn person. Are you stubborn? That's what you got to ask yourself. Or you say, okay, Sister Rose. When I come to people and tell them things that's true and it's to help them, the ones that's not stubborn say, okay, I'll change that. Real nice. Them stubborn ones. I mean, I didn't even know I did anything wrong. Well, now you do. And I was trying to do the right thing, and that's what I was doing. You ain't tried nothing. You did exactly what you wanted to do. And I'm looking, I'm thinking, wow. And I mean, set in their way. I said, bugged out. That's the way I feel. I know I'm not perfect. Oh, no. Far from it. But that's something, you know, when I said that to her, or to him, I didn't mean no harm. Yes, you did. Why did you say that? Why did you do that? What's the motive behind it? People are full of wrong motives. They do things for crazy reasons, and that's why they're not blessed. Think about it. I got to get myself together, and I got to do what's right. Listen what he says. Woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord, that take counsel, but they don't come to me, and they're covered with a covering, but not of my spirit, that they may add sin to sin, that walk to go down into Egypt and have not asked at my mouth, he says, to strengthen themselves in the strength of Pharaoh and to trust in the shadow of Egypt. What are you doing going back to the world? You never talked to me or asked counsel. I'm going back here so I can help my parents get saved. They gonna get you. You ain't going to get them saved. They're going to pull you in. Get some counsel. I was talking to a woman I was counseling with this week. I've never seen a person that made that many stupid decisions in my life. I said, you should have had counsel long before you got to this church. And that's where a lot of people mess up at. And if you rebel and you reject it on one level, you're going to do it on another one. I didn't like what you said. Well, it was the way you said it. No. It ain't got nothing to do with the way I said it. You didn't like it. Hear now this, O foolish people, and without understanding, which have eyes and see not, which have ears and hear not. God says, you don't even fear me. I was telling somebody, I said, boy, some of these things these backsliders do, I would be so scared. I'd be thinking, whoa, where am I at that I can think to call? The thing that's coming to your mind, you shouldn't be doing that. You know that's not right. You shouldn't have said that. You shouldn't have did that. You know. If you've ever got the truth, when you do wrong, it's coming to tell you. It's going to, because the truth, you can't do nothing against it. It hangs around and follow you from one place to another. Listen to it. Listen. So I am going to hear what God is telling me and know that he's telling us for our own good, and let's listen to it. See? He said unto me, son of man, I send thee to the children of Israel, to a rebellious nation that hath rebelled against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me even unto this very day. For they are impudent children and stiff-hearted. I do send thee unto them. Thou shalt say unto them, thus saith the Lord. And they, whether they will hear or whether they will forbear, for they are a rebellious house, yet shall know that there hath been a prophet among them. You can say what you want. After hearing this message tonight, you're going to know God spoke to Sister Rose, to us. He spoke to us, to our hearts, to our minds. He said, I don't care whether they like it or not. If they don't like it, tell them anyway. I would just rather that you don't bother me. If you're in this church, I'm going to bother you. Oh, yes. And when you leave, I won't bother you unless I walk up on you somewhere, and that's not likely. The word of the Lord also came unto me, saying, son of man, thou dwellest in the midst of a rebellious house, which have eyes to see and see not, they have ears to hear and hear not. And he said, for they are rebellious. So what does it tell us? That rebellion keeps us from seeing. Rebellion keeps me from hearing. You are not going to escape. No matter how you look at it, you're not going to escape. But you've been told, do it. Change it tonight. Quit talking about it. I'm really going to get it right. I'm really going to change it. Do it now. Because the quicker you get in, the more likely you will stay in. You keep putting it off, it's never good. Never good. Listen, you don't have to be there. Scribes and Pharisees, they sometimes, he spoke in parables, even for the disciples to understand. Let me show you the thing in the natural compared over here to the spiritual, and that's how he talked to his people. Well, sometimes you're not going to get to talk spiritually, like, huh? You got to tell them about the cockroaches running across the floor. and you step on him and kill him, that's what the devil going to do to you while you run across the floor. He's going to step on you and kill you. Then they say, oh, that's it. I was out in the workout room the other day, and I saw this little black bug, and he looked like he was really going fast because I wanted to get killed in here. And after a while, I said, what are you doing in here? I just get the feeling that he thinks, I got to get across here quick. And I looked down at him. I thought, you're going nowhere. I'm stopping you dead right here. All of a sudden, it's like the thing I feared have happened to me. And that's why every person in this church, I'm telling you, the devil's looking for why you're running, thinking you're going to get away. All of a sudden, whoop, it's over. You say, he dropped dead. He's in an accident. He got killed last night. The first thing my mind's going to go to, oh, my God. How were they in the church? How rebellious were they? Were they good? Were they good in their heart? Did they have it together? I'm going to think all that stuff. I would like to be able that if I had to preach another member's funeral, I could say, if there's somebody called me, Sister Rose so-and-so died, oh, boy, they're in heaven. Or do I say, they probably went to hell. I hope that ain't none of you. That's a tragedy. Because that place you don't come out of. You don't come out of. You stay. And that's another thing I think the devil plays people's play mind games with people. You know why? Because we can't comprehend forever. Because nothing in this world is forever. So when we talk about going to hell and forever and forever and forever, the mind don't grasp that. Forever? What is forever? We've never experienced anything forever. In this life, everything changes. But hell is real. You're never, never, never coming out. You can't fix it on the other side. It got to be fixed here. So what do? I listen to what God is saying to me, because what he's trying to do is fix you for the kingdom. Be sure that you're right. That's what he's trying to do. If you'll listen to him. I marvel at my little girl. Is it Janie? That girl is amazing. She come to this church. Oh, my God, never heard it on this fashion before. I'm never leaving here. And no matter all the things that has happened to her in this process, I'm still not leaving. I'm never leaving here. See, some people come in and say, look, whatever it takes, that's what I'm doing. Sister Rose, you ain't got to talk hard to me. I'm going. Nobody had to talk hard to me and rebuke me and reprove me. And I said, honey, I came in to go. Not for a while, but to the end. You got to find out if your mind's made up. I'm going to stay with it. Or would you say, now, if something like that would happen to me, I don't know if I'd make it or not. Nothing that bad can happen to me that would make me wonder, I don't know if I can stay safe. Just think about hell for a minute. Oh, you can stay safe. To go to a place where you're never coming out, that is overwhelming. It's overwhelming. But when you get blind, don't see, if he can keep you in that state of mind, he has you and he knows it. Because now you're blind, now you're deaf, and now you're wrapped up in chains and fetters. He's not letting you go. He said, I want to let go. I want to get back in. It's not easy. But you can do it. But don't take the chance. Don't gamble with it. There's a good chance you won't win. Because the devil knows his game, and he knows how to play man. Hell is full of people that didn't listen. Hell is full of people that's rebellious, that didn't hear what thus saith the Lord. What is God saying to you? Don't think about nobody else in this church. What's he saying to you? That's where you got to look. What's going on? Because where you may be, the other person may not be there. But you may be somewhere. I was listening to that Dollar Man the other day. I thought, boy, you, all them people sitting up in that place and you deceiving them. And he's talking about, chaka-paka-ta-ta-ka-paka. I thought, that ain't no tongue. A-saka-paka-ka-paka-ka-paka-ka. And he really acted like he was feeling God. I mean, walking around, chaka-paka-ka-paka-ka-ka. I'm sitting there thinking, well, I wish I could tape that. I said, listen to this. And the folks just excited, and he took them all to hell. And God's talking to me. I thought, brother. It ain't it. You know what? When you really know God, you understand the tongue. You got your little regular everyday tongue. I mean, you don't have for 30 years that you could actually know by the Holy Ghost. I do nothing. You don't sit so long. That's it. Same old thing. Never get a new tongue. The heavenly language has many words. You're still talking, but honey, come on here. You got to get it together. Listen to what I'm telling you. I said, listen. The scripture says, Paul said, their minds were blinded up until this day. They're still blind. They don't see. It's tragic. Please take this and say, you know what? Sister Rose, from this day forward, I'm going to take this. I'm not going to put it off that I'm going to change next week because it's not promised to you. You don't have that promise. We don't know when. We all know when. We say, well, I got some time. You don't know when. You don't know where. And people sit under this ministry and hear the truth week in and week out and still the same person. That makes me very tired. It's like, come on, have I got to tell you again and again? And again, come on. I told Pete the other day, once you start praising God, Zach, you'll be just coming off the front of church, walking around praising God. It's that simple, but the flesh says, man, you can't walk. You praise God, you could walk. It's the truth. But he sits there like this. He says, I'm doing everything I could. I can. No, you're not. I'm doing everything you can. I love it when people try God. So I can do this. See if it works. Try it. But it just takes a praise, that's all. Just a praise. I'm going to change this. I'm going to start listening. See, listening means that I heard you. I really heard you. Because listening and paying attention means I'm going to change it. I'm going to do something about it. It's not going to stay this way. God sent prophets year after year and after year to his people, telling them what you should do, what you should do, what you should do. Leave that alone. I don't like that. This is what I love. You ought to seek everything that pleases God will make a difference in your life if you do it. If you do it. So change it. So that when your time comes, and we all have a time, that I'm not afraid. I know if death comes for me now, I'm not going to have a problem at all with death. Because, hey, to be at home with the Lord, to be at home with the Lord is far better than to be here. Why would I fear that? Heaven? Because you ain't sure you're going there. Yeah. Right tonight, if we had somebody suddenly couldn't breathe, they disturbed the whole service. It's wrong. I'm not coming. And if they can holler, they're going to holler. Sometimes they ain't got enough wind to holler. It's my heart. It's my heart. Give me a call 911. I mean, I even see 911. I mean, I don't go like that. My uncle told me about the preacher at home before he died. He said he got up in the pulpit, preached a good message. After he got through, sat down and died. That's how quick death can come. David said, one step between me and death, just one. The very next step could be mine. And how much truth did you get, and what did you do with it? Otherwise, it's a waste of my time for you. Listen to it. So I'm going to take this. Sister Rose, you're going to see a difference in me. See, I know I know Mary, Topaz heard me. Tasha heard me. Minnie sure heard me. Say, what about me, Sister Rose? I'm not sure. I'm not sure. Let's see some action. Let's see some change. Then I'll start believing you. Because then you go, it'll be heard. And you know they're not doing this on their own. This is, wow, it's God. Where is he at in your life? And what have you not listened to and put on hold and is still on hold after all these years and you still haven't changed? You got to change if you want to make it. That's an absolute must. I must hear. I must understand. I must see. Not just have eyes and don't see nothing. Samson said, then let me die with my enemies. If you would forgive me one more time and give me another chance, then let me die today with my enemies. That's kind of a bittersweet thing. Yeah, you got your strength back and your enemies went down, but you went down with them. Nothing is better than when your enemies go down and you're still standing. Nothing is better than that. I hope you'll take this message tonight and say, you know what, Sister Rose, you've been telling me stuff for years. Please, in the very near future, let me be able to say, hey, you changed. You changed. Because I will guarantee you, if you change, I'm glad to tell you that. Because I love to see change. Because it's rare. Every now and then. Wow. Look at that. And continue. Continue. Say, Lord, I ain't going to stop here. I'm thankful for what you did for me, but I'm moving on. I know you can give me even more. He can do it. You got to hear. You got to see. You got to understand. And then after I hear all that, understand all of it, then I apply it. Do what I'm told to do. If you go to the doctor and you're sick and he says, you cut your hand or something, here, take this ointment, put it on 3 times a day. Now, if you don't apply it 3 times, they don't used to going back to the doctor and say, this stuff don't work. So did you do it 3 times a day? No. That's why it's not working. Same way with the word of God. Did you do it every day? Did you pray every day? I don't like people to go tell me a prayer was good this week. You only had a week. Don't you have prayer good every week? That's the place you want to reach and maintain and stay there because it determines whether you're going to be saved or not. I tell you, the devil got a plan for people, and that is catch them on the down. When they're on the down, that's when you throw them in, that's when you throw them. And then you bind them up, put their eyes out, and I control them from here on in.